Welcome to another video on defining coordinates and the coordinate systems we use to locate ourselves on planet Earth. In this video, I'm going to talk a little bit about the state plane coordinate system. So to review a little bit, our general way of locating ourselves is using the longitude-latitude system of coordinate references, which basically is really good for referencing ourselves on our spherical globe, because we've taken our spherical globe and we've basically divided it up into a lot of segments. We have established our equator as essentially being our x-axis, and then we basically contrived a y-axis as a line that runs from the North Pole to the South Pole, the polar poles, not the magnetic pole. And for example, we're using the axis of rotation as our basis for that. So we're establishing a line that runs from the North Pole to the South Pole, and then the line also passes through Greenwich, England, and so that establishes our prime meridian. And then we kind of developed this thought experiment where we're sitting at a point at the center of our globe, and then the angle at which we tilt our head sort of helps us to find the angle on the angle that we use helps to find the latitude of the place that we're looking at on the planet. So it's the angle that is established as from a plane that's essentially the plane that passes through the planet at the equator, and then it's the angle between that reference plane and the point on the surface. And then that establishes the latitude, and then the longitude is basically established by orienting ourselves so that the prime meridian would be kind of directly across from us, and then the angle that we have to turn to face or point ourselves towards the object on the surface, that angle is our longitude. So it's pretty simple to think about, and if we establish ourselves into hemispheres, like we have the Western Hemisphere is basically, if we're looking at the prime meridian, then the Western Hemisphere would be to the left, the Eastern Hemisphere falls to the right, and then everything north of the equator is the Northern Hemisphere, and then everything in the southern to this below the equator is in the Southern Hemisphere. But the system that we use, the longitude-latitude system that we use, is not especially accurate. I mean, it'll get us to where we sort of want to be. It'll help us find our city, our town. It may help us find our backyard. It may help us find our house. But it's not a good system to use when you're trying to establish property boundaries. So when you're trying to do some very detailed, very large-scale mapping, you really don't want to be using latitude-longitude coordinates. But like I said, sometimes they'll show up on maps. They'll show up on parcel maps. They'll show up on plat maps just to kind of get us into the area. But you'll find state plane coordinates are going to be far more accurate and far more readily available, particularly if you have to go to your city planning office or your property value assessor's office, your PVA office, to look at parcel boundaries. And most of the surveying that's done in the United States is done using state plane coordinates. If you go to Walmart and buy a consumer grade GPS that they have in their case, those are not very accurate. Now, they may say on the box that it will get you within plus or minus a meter, which may seem pretty accurate, but a meter, if you remember, it's about 3.25 feet. And so the point that you're going to be mapping is going to be somewhere within a 6-foot diameter, or it's going to be somewhere within a circle with a radius of 3 feet. So that's not very accurate. It's not accurate to do anything. If your property is bumping up against your neighbor's property and you're trying to install like a fence, if you're trying to plant trees or a hedge, or if you're trying to establish ownership, that's not good enough. And actually, because of property is a very special legal environment, you don't have the right to say where things are. So you have to hire a licensed land surveyor to come and map your property just to make sure you know where things are located. There is lots of discrepancies. I've been in this business for almost 30 years. I've worked with a lot of surveyors. I've been to a lot of conferences and conventions where surveyors have shows or give demonstrations. There are some absolute horror stories of things that people have done, including building homes and running electric on property that they thought they owned because they went out and they bought a GPS from Walmart and they thought they knew where they were at. And they literally would build homes and install water and electric on property that does not belong to them. So it's really, really ridiculous. So you might think, and I've run across people all the time that challenge me on this, and they'll say, well, I don't need the government telling me where things are and blah, blah, blah. But the thing is like, you're going to be the one that has legal issues if you decide to go to Walmart and buy one of these GPS units. The other thing that I want to point out about these GPS units, and it's not exactly true with your phone, because your phones work a little bit more in real time than those GPS units do. Okay, and what I mean by that is this. Your phone, like I have a Samsung Galaxy S10, and it has a few GPS apps installed on it. So your phone does this. Your phone has an active GPS in it, so it gathers active GPS data nonstop for the most part. It also is attached to your cellular network. So your cellular network allows you to refine your position even more closely than what the satellite would give you, because not only are you triangulating off of satellites now, but you're also triangulating off of cell phone towers. So it's able to kind of lock your position in even better. If you are attached to Wi-Fi, if you have a Wi-Fi signal, if you take your Wi-Fi signal plus you add in your cell phone network coverage plus the GPS, you actually get some pretty darn good points. Pretty quickly, actually. To contrast that with the GPS that you get at Walmart, those are going to give you, as soon as they acquire satellites, as soon as it gathers four or more satellites, usually once it gathers four satellites, it'll start reporting a position, which is fine. You'll get a position point. The problem is it takes a lot of time and a lot of processing, sort of, for those points to lock themselves in. And you'll notice that once the satellites come up and you have four or more satellites, that the latitude longitude coordinates will still fluctuate. Or if you have moved your GPS into another coordinate system, those points will still adjust themselves for a while, maybe 20 minutes, maybe 30 minutes. If you read the technical documentation on a lot of those handheld units, they don't get precise levels. They don't get the advertised accuracy until almost 45 minutes later. And you have to be on that spot for 45 minutes. You can't be out walking around. You can't go on your hike and say, okay, well, I'm going to hike for at least I'll hike for an hour. So as I hike for an hour, at least my GPS will become more accurate. No, it does not work that way, because as you move, those points and your accuracy and the satellites are constantly moving, and your accuracy will never be the advertised accuracy on the box, because you're moving, the satellites are moving in space and in time, and you're always going to be off. The only way to get an accurate point from the only way to get the advertised accuracy on those GPS units that you get from Walmart or Target or whatever is to stay on that point for somewhere, anywhere, it depends on the time of the day, but anywhere from about 30 to 45 minutes. It means you can't walk around, can't wander off, you can't do anything. You have to remain stable in that position for a while, 30 to 45 minutes. When you see survey crews out, they will establish a base station. They will establish a base station that's set on a tripod that has a GPS transceiver unit sitting on top of it, the little white dome thing. And it will stay on site for most of the day. It depends on how long their mapping operation is, but they'll usually show up about an hour ahead of time and get their unit set up and get it collecting points and get it collecting stable points. They will move around. They will move their transit around. They'll move their rod around and do things like that. But their base station that they set up is going to be stable pretty much throughout the course of their entire mapping operation. That won't move. And there's a reason for that, is because once you move it, then you have to wait for everything else to settle down and adjust. So, while it may be fun and cool to have a GPS unit that you can wander around with, and they're good, they'll get you within, usually have a matrix. So the matrix will say, if you stay on point for 5 minutes, you'll have 9 meter accuracy, which 9 meters is about 30 feet. So 30 feet accuracy means that the real point is going to be within a 30 foot radius of where you're standing, the real point, right? So it's not going to be, the true point is not going to be where you're standing. The point that it's reporting is a point that's somewhere within a 30 foot radius of where you're standing. So 30 feet, it may keep you out of the water. It may not help you when it comes time to, like, if you're hiking and you're in a rugged area, it may lead you off a cliff. There have been a few cases, it doesn't happen very often, of people getting lost, or the mapping software that allows you to send you on your hike and things doesn't account for topography very well. So you really have to do your homework, and that's why I make these videos, is because there's a lot of misinformation out there, and there's a lot of things that people engage in there's a lot of thinking that people engage in that they just don't have a basis of knowledge in. So that's why it's important. That's why these geography classes are important. And whether you take one at a community college or a local university, it's important to know that there's a level of technology out there that impacts your life and impacts your literal, maybe day-to-day decision making. So the way that UTM systems work is this. If you've watched some of the other videos, and we know about how UTM is created, well, state plane is basically sort of the same thing. It's another grid system. It uses feet as its measurement unit, and it basically establishes a meridian that runs down the middle of the area that we're interested in mapping. So like in this particular graphic, you can see that we have a central meridian running down the center of the area that we're interested in mapping. So we're going to make sure, again, like we did with the UTM, we're going to make sure that we set an origin that's well outside of the area that we want to map. We're also going to make sure that our origin is below and usually to the left of the area, or to the west, however you want to think about it, of the area that we want to map, because we want all of our points to be positive points. We want them all to be positive. We're not going to put an origin that's somewhere inside our area, because once we establish our x's, then we end up having some coordinates that are positive and some that are negative and some that are both negative, and it just makes for messy calculations. So I've seen people do this before, and they think, oh, well, I'm going to stand in the middle of my study area, and this, my middle of my study area, will be my origin, and then I'll just create my axes this way. And then they come to me and they say, hey, this is really kind of complicated, how do I fix this? And I say, you fix it by doing it over again, because you need to set your origin always set your origin outside your area of what you're trying to study. So the central meridian basically gives us a way of establishing what that distance is, right? So in this particular case, we have a central meridian that's running down the middle of our study area, and then 2 million feet to the west of that central meridian is where our origin is going to be. So you have to be a little bit familiar with the geography of your area. You have to be familiar with the size and the shape of the area in which you intend to map. And so when you decide what that central meridian is, you're like, okay, well, if once you establish what this area is, as denoted by this red line here, you're like, okay, let's pick an origin that is going to help me figure out, you know, what my coordinate should be. So it could be, you know, when I look at this, I'm like, why didn't they pick 1,000,000 feet? Well, maybe 1,000,000 doesn't give them enough distance, and so they pick 2,000,000 feet. And it doesn't really matter as long as you pick a distance that's well outside your area. The issue becomes this. So what if the area were to grow by accretion? What if they were to buy more counties or something like that, or buy property or whatever these things happen to be? It allows your area to grow a little bit. So this gives them a good buffer. There's a southern offset here. I'm not really sure. It doesn't really have it denoted on here. It's going to be measured in feet, but we're mostly concerned with this 2,000,000 feet right here. Most of the time, you'll pretty much have an area that's self-contained. But like when you're mapping states, and most states have a state plane system, states have these weird shapes, and sometimes they're really long, and sometimes they have weird stuff that comes off of them, like Utah or Oklahoma. Sometimes they're really big, and they cross multiple lines of longitude. And so once you begin to cover a lot of territory, it really helps you out if you split the state into zones to help make your mapping easier. Because if you go back and look at some of the videos on the UTM system, so the central meridian is one of your lines of construction. That's the line that kind of helps you figure, you know, when you've decided whether you're going to use a conic type projection or a cylindrical type projection, that's the line of construction of against which you know where your scale is sort of stable, where your scale is going to be sort of 1-to-1. And then away from these lines of construction, you have more distortion, right? So if you're dealing with a large area like a state, you're going to have to split your state into multiple zones. Now, some states have chosen not to do this. Kentucky is one state where they have a north zone and a south zone, but they also have a single zone, and I'll explain why that happens here in a minute. But you want to choose a projection that best fits the shape of the area, like a state, like a cylindrical or a conic. So if you imagine a state like Illinois, for example, which has a long latitudinal dimension to it, and Indiana. So what you're going to want to do is pick a projection that the construction lines basically are parallel to the edges of those states, right? So we're basically going to have like a normal cylindrical projection, or you could have a conic that has been transverse conic. So if you think about, and the reality is you probably would not want a conic projection for a state like Illinois or Indiana. A conic would be better suited for Kentucky, for example. Any of the square states like Colorado or Wyoming. The longer states, the ones that have like Tennessee, for example, would have a transverse cylindrical. Kentucky could have a transverse cylindrical. Any of the square states could have a transverse cylindrical. Conics really aren't set up very well to do states that have a shape like Illinois or Indiana for the most part. They'd want to stick with some type of cylindrical projection for those. Like I said earlier, the units for state plane coordinates are in feet. The one drawback to state plane coordinates is this, and I'll show this in an upcoming map, is that once the coordinate systems basically start over with each zone, right? So in this particular case, we have We have a southern limit of the zone is down here. So we have, this is basically going to be the northern zone. So we got another southern zone down here. They use the same coordinate system. So it makes it hard to go through and match data up, because if you want to combine stuff in the north zone and the south zone, they use the same set of coordinates, and so they overlay on one another. And then each state has their own system for state plane coordinates, and so things can get kind of messy pretty fast. That's why when you do state plane coordinates, it's really for large-scale mapping. And what I mean by large-scale mapping is you're looking at the local levels. You're looking at scales that are 1 to 200 or 1 to 800 or 1 to 1200. So the idea being let me see if I can do a screen draw here, and we will just see what happens. So if you have a scale, think about this. So we have, I'm going to draw this 800, right? So this is the same thing as saying at 1 over 800, right? It's the same thing. Those are equivalent statements. So which number is larger, 1 divided by 800 or 1 divided by, I really should be doing this with a pen, but I'm doing it with a mouse. So which number is larger, 1 divided by 800 or 1 divided by 24,000? Well, clearly, the 1 divided by 800 is closer to the real, it's closer to 1 to 1, which is 1, right? So that is a closer number than this. Right, that number is not very close to 1, but this is much closer to 1. So that's the way you think about scale. So something that's large scale, it's closer to 1, and something that's smaller scale is not so close to 1. So, and that's what happens with these. That's why with state plane coordinates is that they're really good for large scale mapping. And 1 to 800, 1 to 800, 1 to 1200, those are all fairly common scales at which municipalities will map things. And sometimes it'll even get smaller than that, but not that often. Usually about 1 to 800, 1 to 1200 is about what you're looking at. And then 1 to 24,000 is the scale of a topographic map. Get out of this marker. All right. So here we have Kentucky state plane coordinates, and so we have, this is a kind of a confusing graphic to look at, because we actually have three different coordinate systems illustrated on this single graphic. I wish they had different slides for different coordinate systems, but we're gonna have to grin and bear this out. So the blue zone, the blue area here, the solid blue line is the state plane coordinate system for the northern part of Kentucky. The dashed lines indicate the standard parallels, and then the dashed line that runs down the middle is the central meridian for this coordinate system. And so the bottom corner down here is, this is the latitude of origin. So they've established a latitude of origin that's well outside the northern part of Kentucky, and then we have a central meridian. This latitude of origin is 37.5 degrees north. Then there's a parallel at 37, almost 38. There's another one at almost 39. And the central meridian is at 84.25 degrees west. Right, so we have some of these projection parameters set up. That we can tell that this is a train. We can tell that this. Actually, I don't think we can tell unless we look at it. This is a Lambert conformal conic, so we know this is a conic projection. I can kind of read the small print down here. So it tells us what the projection is, a Lambert conformal conic. Don't worry too much about the Lambert. The conic tells you what kind of geographic surface we're using, though. So that tells you that, and now that we have two standard parallels, where we can infer from that that it's also a secant, because if it was just a regular conic, we would just have a singular parallel. In this case, we have two standard parallels, so that tells us we're dealing with a secant type projection. So that allows us, so along this dotted line here, that's where our scale factor is 1, where there's no distortion, and then we have increasing levels of distortion away from those lines of construction. So the red zone is our south zone. And I'm going to advance to the next slide for that. So we have our south zone. So we have our central meridian is this red line. We have our latitude of origin is 37.5 degrees north. And then we have our standard parallels here. So again, we know we're dealing with a secant conic. And in fact, it tells us that we're dealing with a conformal conic, which is a form of a conic projection, and Lambert is actually the name of the fellow who developed this projection. So we have a lot of the projection parameters set up for the north zone and the south zone, but they both use different axes, and because of that, they both use a different projection set of projection parameters. But what ends up happening is the origin for this north zone and the origin down here for the south zone end up being almost identical in terms of the way they develop their coordinate axes. And so when it comes time to map, these will actually lay on top of each other. So it's you have to know what zone a projection is in, because it'll, like in south zone, north zone, and actually they have codes. So it's important to know if you're in the north zone or your south zone, and also the software will also require you to provide information about what zone you're in. All zones, whether you're in a UTM zone or a state plane zone, all have a federal information processing system code. In this particular case, the federal information processing system code, the FIPS code for the projection is 1602, and this is the high accuracy reference network. And it's also in US feet. So there's a lot of parameters out here to kind of be aware of. And this is why it's important to know everything about your data, know as much as you can about your data. You may not be able to know everything about it, but you need to know quite a bit about your data, especially when you're mapping states like this, because if somebody gives you data in north zone and data in south zone, what you'll end up, the technical, what you'll actually have to do in order to get these things to kind of overlay appropriately is you will have to reproject your data from one zone to the next zone. And that's possible. The issue that you'll have, though, is when you do that, let's say we're going to take the north zone and reproject it into south zone. So it'll that way the coordinate systems, the software knows how to fix things so that they will appear to be in the same projection. And for all intents and purposes, they are in the same. They're all going to be in the same projection, the same coordinate system. But if you consider this, this is our line of construction. If you take this northern part and reproject it into the south zone, now these lines of construction now apply to all the data up here. So, and what did I say about where error occurs? Error occurs the further away you get from your lines of construction. So in this particular case, the northern part of Kentucky around Cincinnati, the data that you might be reprojecting that has to deal with information up here is not going to be very good. My experience has been that when you do reprojections like this, your data could be off by several meters. So if you're trying to do land cover mapping, if you're trying to determine forest types, forest classification, land cover classification, If you're trying to match things up with satellite imagery, it's not going to go well for you. Your error is going to be pretty significant into the fact that it's probably not going to be very useful. The reason why you would go through and put and combine these two data sets like this is basically for cartographic purposes, for show and tell, where you want to show a map of the results of whatever project you've been working on. Throughout the course of that project, you will probably keep these as two separate data files. You would handle them as two separate data files and treat them as two separate data files and only combine them later on when most of your analysis is already complete and you wanted to show your total area in a cartographically or as a map or in some type of a graphics or media document. Otherwise, your results are just going to be you're going to be really challenged by your accuracy. That's been my experience anyway. Just to show you how some other states, I'll show you Pennsylvania here in a minute, but here's how Oregon does theirs. This is a nice reference map that they have for showing you how they have divided their state. They have their parallels set up. They have their latitude of projection origin, their central meridian, their second standard parallel, their northern extent. So you have all these projection parameters set up. They have established this. Their datum is the North American vertical datum of 1988. The horizontal datum is 1983. They're using international feet. Pardon me, they're using the GRS 1980 as their spheroid. Their false origin, so we even know their false origin is settled way outside the state. In fact, it's probably in the Pacific somewhere, just off the coast, actually. And we know what their what their furthest easting is. So we know how their projection has been set up. So it's always good to know, when you move from state to state, or if you're trying to combine information from states, just exactly what to expect when you're sharing data. So here's Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania's been broken latitudinally into a north zone and a south zone. So they use the same central meridian for both the north zone and the south zone, which is convenient for Pennsylvania because it's kind of a rectangle. It's just kind of a larger rectangle than what people want to deal with, and so they've divided it into two parts along county boundaries. So we have two standard parallels, so we know from previous experience that we're dealing with a secant, and this is probably a conic. I didn't really do a lot of background work on this one, but just to kind of show you how different states handle their geography. But we do have a central meridian. We have a common meridian, but we're going to have different standard parallels for each, the north zone and the south zone. And I've been in doing some background work for the state plane. There's not a lot of good documentation. There should be, because all these things are established by law. And so there should be reports out there. So I should know, for example, what the false origin should be for Pennsylvania. And I'm sure it's out there in a legal document, but anyway, I just want to show you how Pennsylvania handles their situation. So here's a map, and I know I've kind of obscured the American Northwest, but this map shows you how each state has divided itself into zones. So we have Nebraska, and Nebraska's interesting, and Montana's really interesting because they both have single zones, which I find, I just struggle with that even today, because they're both, like, Nebraska's a pretty big state. We can look at Missouri. Missouri has three separate distinct zones. Kansas has three zones, or two, I'm sorry. Colorado has three zones. Wyoming has four. And you can see how they've chosen different, like, they're both fairly rectangular states. And while Utah and Colorado have elected to divide their states into kind of a top and a middle and a northern and a central and a southern portion. We have western and eastern and a little west and a little east. Not exactly sure what they call those. These zones all have numbers anyway. I'm just kind of contriving my own names for these. But like we have a north zone and a south zone, but each one of those zones has a number. I think that's 601 and that's 602. And then all of Kentucky, the single zone for Kentucky is called 1600, 1600. So Illinois would have codes for each of their eastern and their western half, and then you have a eastern, a central, and a western half for Missouri. But you can see right away that every state has divided themselves up in some way, with some exceptions like Montana, Nebraska, Tennessee, South Carolina, I mean North Carolina, South Carolina, and like the state of Massachusetts, you know, it's small enough, and Connecticut's small enough to where they can just get by with a single zone, whereas Colorado, California has six zones. So, and that just helps, you know, with the larger states, and I'm not really sure about how many zones Alaska has. I'm sure Alaska probably has several, just like Texas has five. But that allows them to go through and create a unique and accurate mapping set of mapping coordinates for each of these different segments in for Texas, for example. But I want to point out that each one of these zones uses this basic, they don't use the same, like exact same axes, but they use an axes that have the same numerical units. I don't know if that makes sense. So for example, you know, the origin here is going to be, there's going to be probably be an origin right there, and then the y-axis and the x-axis will extend like that. Then there'll be another set of axes, and they basically use, they're going to reuse the same numbering system, right? And so when you go through and map these, the northern part of Texas will map onto this north central part of Texas. And that's why it's important to keep these things straight in your head as to what's going on, because they use, you know, they're basically reusing, recycling the same axes for all of these. So it gets kind of confusing once in a while. And I've seen, like, people who are just getting into mapping, they don't understand why the areas overlay one another. And I'm like, that's because they're using exactly the same axes. And they're like, well, that's stupid. I'm like, well, not really. That's the way the system is set up, and it actually works really well. You just have to pay attention to what you're doing. To point this out, sometimes a software, like some of the ESRI software, will hold your hand a little bit, and if it detects, like if there's projection parameters already filled out, like within the metadata, and ESRI software sort of detects those things, it will lay things together and make it appear as if they are all in the same projection. The problem is they're not in the same projection, and your analyses will all be off. So it's important that if you're doing some type of analysis on a wide range of areas, like particularly like what would happen, like what I'm suggesting is this, what if your study area falls on a boundary zone? So you would probably want to establish initially before you began the project what zone is going to be your base zone for your analysis, and then use and then convert everything over. That way, all of your study area is within your is within that estate plane system. Because if it's not, your analysis is going to be garbage, because the software is not going to look at it doesn't use the visual depiction as its analysis window. It not all the time. I got to be careful how I say that. But it looks at the underlying coordinate information, but it redisplays, it reprojects things on the fly for display purposes, but not for analysis purposes. So you really have to be aware of what's kind of going on behind the scenes when you're doing your analysis, and making sure that your data is appropriately in the appropriate grid system. So I have. Um, See what happens when I click this. It should launch a window. So the thing is, how do you go about getting your maps, your topo maps? Well, there's a great tool provided by the USGS that allows you to go through and find topographic maps. So this will take a little bit to load because my machine's being taxed because of all the stuff that I'm doing on it right now. But the USGS has this topo view. And if you click this button called View and Download Maps Now, it'll load a viewer. We're going to skip over the view here. And if you know where you want to go, you know, you can just zoom into it. But if you don't know where you want to go, if you have a better idea and you want to fine tune it, like you want to go to Durango, Colorado, who doesn't want to go there? It's a beautiful place. And it's going to lock us into Durango, Colorado. And it's going to show us. See, there's no. And I'm going to pick. Maps that are in the range of 1 to 24,000. Oh, and there may not be any. I don't understand. Okay, evidently I have to be patient when I... So I think my screen capture software may be interfering with my web page, for example. Things aren't really moving very fast. But anyway, so we do have a 1898 topographic map for Durango, Colorado at a scale of 1 to 62,500. And we can get a GeoTIFF or a GeoPDF. We can download a JPEG, and there is a KMZ file which we can import into Google Earth. But we also have other options. We have a 1963 and a 2011 Durango West, which is at a scale of 1 to 24,000. And so if I click on that, that will help me fine-tune my selection. I can see that I have 41 options available to me. And then if I select on one of these, let's just scroll down to something, well, I don't know, let's find something. Here's a one from 1908. That's 1 to 25,000. Let's find Wow, that website's having a struggle, so I'm going to have to move on. I'm not really sure what's happening to it, but it's working. It's just working really slowly. But I did use that website to download a GeoTIFF of my local area, which I will show you here shortly. But you're allowed to. You can download these beautiful USGS topographic maps in GeoTIFF and GeoJPEG and JPEG format, which allows you to embed them in your map application. So here's one of the GeoTIFFs that I downloaded, and I inserted it into a ArcGIS Pro map document. And you can tell that it's positionally where it's supposed to be. The city of Murray is right here. And I've gone through and verified that the coordinates and everything match up. So it's right where it's supposed to be, which is great. This is the corner section. I know this actually has aerial photography that's the map has been superimposed upon. So that's why it looks a little different than the map on the right. This is what a traditional USGS, when the 24,000 topographic map would look like with all of its marginalia. And The image on the left basically has an orthophoto as the base map with all the grid and everything else superimposed on it. So you can get those with or without orthophotography, and some of them don't have it to begin with, so don't get don't think that you're going to get orthophotography on every USGS topographic map that you will find, because it doesn't work that way. Some have the imagery and some don't. Like I said in a previous video, they don't update these maps all the time. They only update them when there's been a significant amount of change in the area, and then they'll go through and update them. So we can see that the marginalia still has a lot of information. It also says, which is another thing that you really want to pay attention to, is there's a map disclaimer, which most reference maps and a lot of thematic maps are coming with these days because of the level of sophistication. It's just not there with some people, and they think that these maps are legal documents, and they're not really. This map says this is not a legal document. Boundaries may be generalized for this map scale. Private lands within government reservations may not be shown. Obtain permission before entering private lands. And they have information about where the data, the kind of the lineage of the information on the map. And I use the term lineage. It's all the things that go into making this map, the dates and the times and the data sets and things like that. So those are all important to know what the genealogy and the lineage of your map is. And then we have information about the coordinate system. So all these things are important to watch and be aware of. Not all the tick marks and the notations on the maps are not always readily apparent. Even though this map does have UTM grid imposed upon it, it also has tick marks indicating where the state plane feet are located. This map, and I don't have it depicted on this graphic, this map not only contains ticks for Kentucky state plane feet, but as noted here, there's also ticks for the Tennessee coordinate system as well too. So before you go through and make any kind of rough calculations or take rough coordinates off of one of these maps, you're going to want to make sure that you're using the appropriate state plane coordinate system, because both Kentucky and state plane are depicted on this map. Now that's not going to happen on all maps, but as shown in my left graphic here, Callaway County butts up against the Tennessee state boundary. So any area where you are going to come into contact with another state, and particularly on the western edge of Kentucky or the far eastern part of Kentucky where you have multiple states coming together, it's not uncommon to have two or three or maybe even four different state plane coordinate systems on a map depending on where you're located. So sometimes deciding where those ticks are can be really kind of tricky. So make sure when you're taking measurements off of a map that you realize where you're at, and kind of get your ticks consistent within your mind as to where you're located. All right, this wraps up my discussion of state plane coordinates. I do have another video that shows you how to take a measurement using state plane coordinates off of a USGS 24,000 scale map. So I encourage you to watch that. Thank you for your time.